For cells to perform any function, any work, they have to have energy. You can't go jogging or lifting weights if you're tired, because the cell won't work without the help of chemical energy. The main energy currency in the cells is adenosine triphosphate, or ATP. But any nucleoside triphosphate, like guanosine triphosphate, or GTP, will do just fine. For cells to make ATP, a process generating electricity has to take place in our mitochondria. Electricity is power. And thanks to electricity, ATP is made. Now, to create electricity, electron-rich molecules have to deliver electrons to a chain of complexes, called the electron transport chain, which move them to a final acceptor, a molecule of oxygen. And there are two electron donor molecules, nicotinamide adenine dinucleotide, or NADH, and flavin adenine dinucleotide, or FADH2. But of course, the cell has to produce NADH and FADH2 in the first place. And they're produced by critical enzymes called dehydrogenases. Dehydrogenases are the main enzymes found in the citric acid cycle, also known as the Krebs cycle. In fact, the citric acid cycle is a set of 8 enzymatic reactions that start with a molecule called acetyl-coenzyme A, usually just acetyl-CoA. And 4 of the enzymes, or half of them, are dehydrogenases. And in this process, acetyl-CoA gets converted into carbon dioxide. Acetyl-CoA comes from various sources depending on whether you've just eaten or are starving. Let's say that you're hungry and a bit angry, so you're feeling hangry. That's when stress hormones like glucagon, epinephrine, and cortisol start to rise. In this hangry state, fatty acids from triglycerides become the primary source of acetyl-CoA. Now let's say you have a bowl of delicious French onion soup, and everything changes. Insulin is plentiful, and you also have plenty of acetyl-CoA from breaking down glucose, fructose, and galactose, with glucose playing the biggest role. Now, alcohol is also a source of acetyl-CoA in the liver, where it's metabolized. In addition, proteins can also help contribute to acetyl-CoA production. If we take the case of glucose, after a meal, one glucose, which is a 6-carbon molecule, splits into 2 3-carbon pyruvate molecules through glycolysis, which happens in the cytoplasm of the cell. Each of the pyruvate molecules then enter the mitochondria. In the mitochondria, an enzyme called pyruvate dehydrogenase snatches a carbon and 2 oxygens from pyruvate and adds coenzyme A, making acetyl-CoA. In the process, 2 electrons are also transferred to a nearby NAD+, in the form of a hydride ion, making NADH, while the carbon and 2 oxygens are released to form carbon dioxide, or CO2. This step links glycolysis to the citric acid cycle, but really isn't considered part of either process. Even so, it's a source of NADH and CO2, and shares some similarity with enzymes of the citric acid cycle. As we go through the citric acid cycle, we'll keep track of our total GTP, NADH, FADH2, and CO2 count with these counters. And just remember that this cycle has a ton of dehydrogenases. Alright, so the citric acid cycle starts when acetyl-CoA is joined to a 4-carbon molecule called oxaloacetate by an enzyme called citrate synthase, making a 6-carbon molecule, citrate. This process also releases coenzyme A. Next, another enzyme, aconitase, rearranges the chemical shape of citrate to make its isomer, isocitrate, without adding or removing any carbon molecules. So far, we haven't made anything related to energy, but here comes the first dehydrogenase, called isocitrate dehydrogenase, which removes a carbon and 2 oxygens from isocitrate. In the process, 2 electrons are also transferred to a nearby NAD+, in the form of a hydride ion, making our first NADH, and the carbon and oxygens give us our first CO2, leaving us with a 5-carbon molecule called alpha-ketoglutarate. High levels of ATP, as well as high levels of NADH in the cell, can inhibit isocitrate dehydrogenase, signaling the cycle to slow down since the cell has plenty of energy. On the other hand, high levels of ADP, which is an ATP precursor, stimulates this enzyme, signaling the cycle to speed up, since the cell needs more energy. In fact, isocitrate dehydrogenase is considered the rate-limiting step of this whole cycle. Also, calcium levels rise during muscle contraction, and this contraction is work, which requires energy. So as it turns out, calcium also activates the enzyme isocitrate dehydrogenase. Next, another dehydrogenase called alpha-ketoglutarate dehydrogenase converts the 5-carbon alpha-ketoglutarate to the 4-carbon succinyl-CoA, which releases our second molecule of NADH and carbon dioxide in the process. This enzyme requires 5 sidekicks called cofactors to function. And you can remember them by the first letters of the following mnemonic. T-Rex loves and cares for nachos. T for thiamine, or vitamin B1. L for lipoic acid. C for coenzyme A, also called vitamin B5, or pantothenate. F for FAD+, also called vitamin B2, or riboflavin. And N for NAD+, also called vitamin B3, or niacin. So adequate intake of these vitamins is essential, because deficiencies can disrupt the citric acid cycle, and impact overall health as a consequence. For example, thiamine deficiency can lead to a disease called beriberi, in which the central nervous system and then the heart can't work properly. Likewise, niacin deficiency can cause a disease called pellagra, characterized by the 4 Ds, diarrhea, dermatitis, dementia, and if the deficiency isn't corrected, death. Yikes. Well, let's say that the cycle is working properly. Then the next step is that an enzyme called succinate thiokinase removes the CoA from succinyl-CoA and turns it into a 4-carbon succinate molecule. It also couples a phosphate and a GDP molecule to the reaction, which ends up producing GTP. Alright, next, the enzyme succinate dehydrogenase transforms succinate to fumarate. In the process, 2 electrons and 2 protons are transferred to FAD to produce FADH2. Also, it's worth knowing that succinate dehydrogenase is already part of the electron transport chain, and it goes by the name complex 2. Next in line is an enzyme called fumarate hydrase, or just fumarase, which adds a water molecule to fumarate, making malate. Malate is then converted to oxaloacetate by the enzyme malate dehydrogenase, making our 3rd and final NADH in the process. So now we've come full circle. Oxaloacetate can then join up with another new acetyl-CoA molecule that's just hanging around waiting to start a new cycle. The control of the citric acid cycle is based on the energy level of the cell. It has to run all the time, so when it needs more energy, it speeds up. And when it has enough energy, it slows down. Hormones don't play a role in its regulation. Alright, as a quick recap. In the end, from 1-acetyl-CoA molecule, we've made 3 NADH, 1 FADH2, 1 GTP, and 2 carbon dioxides. The carbon dioxides leave the cell and are transported in the blood as bicarbonate, thanks to enzymes called carbonic anhydrases. They're then exhaled by the lungs. In the electron transport chain, each NADH makes 3 ATPs, which totals to 9 ATPs, and each FADH2 makes 2 ATPs, which totals to 2 ATPs. Our 1 GTP yields the energy equivalent of 1 ATP, so we've just got 1 there. And so we make a total of 12 ATP molecules per acetyl-CoA. Also, since 1 glucose molecule splits into 2 pyruvates, each glucose molecule yields 24 ATP in the citric acid cycle.